Okay, so if you haven't seen The Family on Netflix yet, I'm going to have to ask you to go ahead and do that. But spoiler alert, Christianity did it. So on the off chance that you're not familiar with it, let me give you the basics. The Family is a 5-part documentary series on the secretive cabal of politicians, businessmen, and religious leaders that seek to control the world through an international anti-democratic network of subversive cells and have managed to influence every U.S. president since Eisenhower. Now, to be fair, there are plenty of Netflix documentaries on that basic subject, but what distinguishes this one is that The Family is real and also not reptilian that we know of. And as tinfoil hat as all of this sounds, this is a real group with real power and a ton of fucking money. They're the guys that put on the national prayer breakfast every year. But despite this insanely visible annual flex, they really didn't rise to national prominence until the whole Mark Sanford scandal broke. You remember the dude who said he was walking the Appalachian Trail when he was really in Argentina banging his mistress? Anyway, in the wake of that scandal, it came out that he was staying in this dirt cheap, gorgeous apartment in D.C. where his rent was being illegally subsidized by a Christian lobbying group. So in the wake of all that, the media starts digging into this group and finds out all kinds of creepy shit. Right. OK, so like one of the main ways that this group gains influence is to find the nobodies of Congress. Right. Some low level representative or ex representative that's a Christian zealot and B, in danger of going unrecognized at his own birthday party. And the use of masculine pronoun, by the way, is not just the lazy sexism of English tradition. They only use men for this anyway. So they take Representative Bubba McCoy or whatever, and they send him on a trip to some country in Africa or Eastern Europe or some country that barely registers at the State Department, and hope the good people of Latveria mistake this for a sanctioned visit by a representative of the U.S. government. Now, imagine this. You're Victor Von Doom. Your country isn't super stable. You need a steady stream of markers that you're a legitimate and powerful leader. Now along comes Bubba McCoy, the highest ranking U.S. official to visit your tiny little shithole country since we needed to trek across it to fight Nazis. Right? You might know he's actually there on some non-governmental religious trip or whatever, but you still roll out the red carpet for him. You have every incentive to play along with the illusion of legitimacy, but more often than not, Bubba's trip is going to be a mix of official duties, personal obligations, and business for the family. So the president of Latveria is usually just a dupe. And what does the family do once they've gained influence in these small nations? Well, maybe you remember Uganda's Kill the Gay bills from 2014. Yeah, that was them. I mean, until it started making press back here in the States, at which time it wasn't them, if you ask them. If you ask the Ugandans that were enacting it, it was still very much them. And look, this is a diatribe, not a 5-part documentary series. So I'm just giving you the tip of the iceberg here. You should definitely watch the whole thing. Warn you ahead of time. It takes a little while to get going. First episode is basically a dude having a rough go of it at Bible camp. But eventually, it's more than worth the time you invested. But I also have to issue a little bit of a warning, because this movie's going to piss you off left and right, back and forth, up and down, and not just in the ways it means to. See, the thing I found myself saying over and over again throughout this entire thing was, but aren't these just Christians Christianing? Isn't the only thing that makes them different the fact that they're good at it? And maybe you dismiss that, right? Because I'm the jaded atheist who sees only the bad in Christianity, or, you know, probably not you, but you know what I mean. But I'd submit that most American Christians watching it would be hard pressed to find anything wrong with what these people were doing. Influencing foreign governments with the word of Jesus? Why, that's noble. Leveraging the apparatus of state to increase the centrality of Christ's message in government policy? Well, that's high-minded. Cavorting with tyrants and malicious dictators and offering them the gospel's message of forgiveness? Why, that's saintly. And I don't even have to invent hypothetical Christians to make my point. We could use any number of the ones interviewed in this documentary. Over and over again, they're presented with these radically anti-democratic things that they've done. And they're like, yeah, then they cooked up some bullshit about me being an unregistered foreign agent. Apparently, covertly undermining your own national interests in a quid pro quo with a hostile foreign leader is suddenly a crime. But I stand by what I did. Over and over again, the Christians wrap their arms around their crimes and give them a big ass hug on camera. And yet, the documentarian is either too timid or too naive to present that. The series goes out of its way over and over again to present the theology of the family as some weird aberration of Christianity, and they do it on the thinnest fucking threads. they make a huge deal of the fact that the people in the Bible studies usually only had a tiny booklet that contained the Gospels and ignored the rest of the Bible, as though that meant they didn't represent true Christianity, right? But the vast majority of American Christians ignore everything but the Gospels, Revelation, and whatever Old Testament passages they need to justify the bigotry du jour. Here's a great example, right? So they talk about the story of David and Bathsheba a couple of times, and the family uses this as an exemplar of how bad people can still be chosen by God. Quick refresher, after he gets done defeating Goliath, David, you know, goes on to be king. He's watching some naked chick splashing around in her tub, decides to rape her. Then he decides he wants to keep raping her, so he arranges to get her husband killed in the war. But despite all that shit, God still favors David and his generations. Now, the real reason for this is because the Bible is a terrible book and all of its heroes are monsters. But the family finds this to be a useful analogy when they're presented with the fact that they've cozied up to some of the most brutal dictators of the last half century. Sure, those people are evil, but they're still chosen by God. Otherwise, they wouldn't be in control of the country. God does everything. This happened. Ergo, God did it. And granted, that's a terrifying justification. But at one point, the documentary refers to it as a radical interpretation of the story of David and Bathsheba. I'm sorry, what the fuck other interpretation is there? How radical can it be if the vast majority of evangelical Christians in America can look at Donald grab him by the pussy Trump and see a man chosen by God? You know, don't get me wrong. I'm glad the documentary is out there. It's information that more people should have, but it inadvertently plays into the same problem it's trying to expose when it goes out of its way to find the real Christians that oppose the family's tactics and goals. And whether or not it does so knowingly, it never acknowledges that the progressive Christian standing up to the assault on the wall of separation is the diminishing minority. They're the radical offshoot, the megalomaniacal sexism that seeks to undermine the will of the people represented by the family is mainstream Christianity.